Spider-Man was released on May 3rd, 2002, and it starred Tobey Maguire, Willem Dafoe, and Kirsten Dunst, and this film was directed by Sam Raimi. Spider-Man was the third highest grossing movie of 2002, and it grossed, well, a crap ton of money. Too many, including myself. Spider-Man started the comic book movie genre we know today and love. Other than Bryan Singer's X-Men, movie fans haven't had seen Marvel characters done justice on the big screen. But we're not talking about the cultural impact of Sam Raimi's Spider-Man. We're talking about how this film follows the hero's journey. In case you don't know what the hero's journey is, let me educate you. And hopefully this video will be far more interesting than 6th grade English class. For thousands of years, stories of great warriors and heroes had followed a general formula, and Professor Joseph Campbell had noticed this. So in 1949, he released a novel, The Hero with a Thousand Faces, where he goes in depth about how some forms of literature, the main protagonist goes on a 12-step journey, or character arc, called the hero's journey. Many forms of media before and after Joseph Campbell's novel was written follows the hero's journey character arc in some form or fashion. Films like Star Wars or The Matrix follows the hero's journey to a T, though this film follows it more loosely and out of order, so I decided to rearrange it a little. Also, this can apply to all the other renditions of Spider-Man's origin story, but I decided to use Sam Raimi's rendition of his origin because it's my personal favorite and it's the one I grew up with. So without further ado,
and now our feature presentation.
Who am I? You sure you want to know? The story of my life is not for the faint of heart. If somebody said it was a happy little tale, if somebody told you I was just your average ordinary guy, not a care in the world, somebody lied.
Peter Parker is a stereotypical nerdy outcast who lives in Queens, New York. He is really skinny, and he gets bullied by Flash Thompson and his goons. Even the bus driver thinks poorly of him. The protagonist is very typical for a kid like him. He has hopes and dreams to stand up for himself against Flash and to make MJ, the girl of his dreams, his girlfriend.
I'd like to tell you that's me next to her. Heck, I'd even take him.
Peter's home life is the only stable factor in his life. He lives with his Aunt May and Uncle Ben. They are both very loving and think the world of him. One of Peter's flaws is that he is very physically and mentally weak. He lets people push him around, sometimes even his best friend Harry Osborn, who steals MJ right in front of him. Peter's supernatural aid comes in the form of a spider. When he is on a science trip with his class, there he is bitten by a radioactive spider. The spider's DNA and Peter's DNA mixes together. As a result, he possesses the power of a spider. Now he has the power of super strength and the ability to climb walls and shoot webs. The guardian of the gate in our story is none other than Flash Thompson himself. When at school, Peter shoots his first web, which attaches to a random lunch tray. In an attempt to get rid of the web, he flings it backward, landing the lunch tray on Flash. Flash, now enraged, chases Peter down. Now, because of Peter's enhanced senses, he is able to block Flash's punches.
Think you're pretty funny, don't you, freak?
Flash, it was just an accident.
My fist breaking your teeth, that's the accident.
Flash attempts to land punches on Peter, but fails. And in the heat of the moment, Peter grabs his arm and punches him across the hall. After Peter's fight at school, he notices the small hairs growing on his fingers that matches the small hairs on a spider's leg. Peter crosses the first threshold when he climbs a wall for the first time. In excitement, he jumps from building to building, then meets a massive gap between two buildings, so he decides to shoot a web again. His web attaches to a nearby crane, and he attempts to swing across. Even though he crashed into a nearby wall, he now has a greater knowledge of his powers. After a conversation with MJ, he decides to participate in a wrestling match with wrestler Bonesaw McGraw. If he beats him, Peter will receive $3,000. With that $3,000, Peter will have enough money to purchase a car to impress MJ. Peter tells Aunt May and Uncle Ben that he is going to the library to do some homework. Uncle Ben decides to drive Peter there, but before he drops him off, Ben decides to give Peter some fatherly advice, or his call to adventure, telling him that despite of his ability to beat Flash up, that does not mean that he should. To quote Jurassic Park,
"Your scientists were so preoccupied with whether or not they could that they didn't stop to think if they should."
He tells him that he is entering manhood, and that he is about to change into the person he is going to remain being for the rest of his life. He reminds him to be careful about who that person is going to be. He simplifies this lesson for him and tells him,
"With great power comes great responsibility."
Peter's refusal of the call is at the bank, where the teller rips Peter off by only giving him $100 rather than the $3,000 that was promised. Moments later, that bank gets robbed, and when the robber is fleeing the scene, Peter lets the guy go, despite of his ability to stop him. The teller tells Peter,
"You could have taken that guy apart. Now he's going to get away with my money."
And Peter responds with,
"I missed the part where that's my problem."
After fleeing the scene, Peter sees a crowd of people gathering. Peter, curious to see what is happening, finds Uncle Ben dying on the street as a result of a gunshot. As Uncle Ben dies, Peter grabs his hand. Peter learns that the suspect in this crime is still on the run, so he decides to take matters in his own hands. He chases the guy down, and after finally getting a glimpse at his face, he realizes that that is the same exact person he let go at the bank earlier that night. After the robber points a gun at Peter's face, he breaks his hand, and the guy trips and falls to his demise. Though this isn't a typical rendition of meeting the mentor of the hero's journey, in my eyes, it is the metaphorical way of how Peter met his mentor. After some time passes, Peter graduates high school. He still feels empty, though, and wishes Uncle Ben was still there at the graduation ceremony. Aunt May reminds him that he would still be extremely proud and never doubted his abilities. Peter opens his briefcase, finding a drawing of the famous Spider-Man outfit. He reminds himself of the call to adventure Uncle Ben gave him. This is when he truly begins to realize what Uncle Ben was trying to teach him earlier. Now with this new wisdom, Peter finally dons the mantle of the Amazing Spider-Man. Throughout Peter's whole life, he has always been under the radar, but now as Spider-Man, it's a whole new antithetical world for him. Now he is everywhere on the radar, and the people of New York have some varying opinions on him.
The guy protects us, you know? He protects the people.
He stinks, and I don't like him.
P- Peter has two main companions throughout our story. His love interest, MJ, and his best friend, Harry Osborn. These are really Peter's only friends, though as time goes on, the relationships begin to get testy due to Peter's life as Spider-Man and his secrecy towards that life, though Peter's dual life as Spider-Man isn't providing him any financial gain, and he can't get a job because his responsibility as Spider-Man will cause him to be late every day, resulting in him getting fired over and over again. He decides to get a job at a local newspaper company, the Daily Bugle, since they are looking for photos of Spider-Man, though the main editor, J. Jonah Jameson, who is played masterfully by J.K. Simmons, doesn't think too highly of the webhead. Since Jameson thinks Spider-Man's a criminal, he is using Peter's photos to further stigmatize the public opinion of Spider-Man. Our first true road of trials is at the Oscorp Unity Day Festival. This is when Spider-Man meets his new enemy, the Green Goblin, or Norman Osborn. He ambushes the festival to get revenge on the bored men who fired him earlier. He is successful at it and literally disintegrates him. Our hero has now met his match. Spider-Man fights him for the first time and even beats him, but his job isn't over yet. MJ is about to fall to her death, though Spider-Man sweeps in and catches her in the nick of time. This is the first time Spider-Man takes on a threat that matches his power level, and Peter begins to learn the rules of this new world. Peter now more than ever realizes that his identity as Spider-Man can never be revealed to anyone, since he lost MJ to the hands of the Green Goblin. Some time passes and Spider-Man meets the Goblin again. He manages to cut him with his spinning blade weapons. This reveals Spider-Man's identity to the Goblin, but as Norman Osborn saw the exact same cut on Peter's arm, the Goblin then ambushes Aunt May's home, nearly killing her. Peter now knows that the Goblin is out for blood, and he receives a message from the Goblin, and now MJ is in trouble. The Goblin gives Spider-Man a choice. He can save MJ, though if he does, he will kill a bus full of children. Though, in true hero fashion, he saves both of them. Though this is a false victory, since the Goblin throws Spider-Man into an old church building. After getting thrown in the church, the Goblin throws a bomb near Spider-Man's face, flinging him backwards, incapacitating him. The Goblin lands his glider to beat Spider-Man to death.
Misery, 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 that's what you've chosen.
As the Goblin beats Peter inches away from death, he threatens the life of MJ again.
Had you not been so selfish, your little girlfriend's death would have been quick and painless. But now that you've really pissed me off, I'm gonna finish her nice and slow.
This sparks a rage in Peter, who gets up and blocks the Goblin's attacks, getting the upper hand on him. After Peter drops a wall on the Goblin, severely weakening him, Peter begins beating down on the Goblin, but the Goblin forfeits, and he removes his helmet. It is revealed to Peter that the Green Goblin is Norman Osborn, the father of his best friend, Harry Osborn. Norman begs for forgiveness and even asks for Peter to accept Norman as his new father, but Peter refuses.
I have a father. His name was Ben Parker.
After after Peter rejects Norman's request, this enrages him. He activates his glider, though Spider-Man uses his spider sense to dodge it. Norman, not being able to evade, gets impaled by his own glider. As Norman dies, he mutters his final words to Peter. He tells him not to tell Harry about any of the events that have just occurred. Spider-Man is now forced to take responsibility for Norman's death. At Norman's funeral, Harry tells Peter that he is the only family that he has right now, and that he blames his father's death on Spider-Man. Later, MJ approaches Peter, confessing her love to him. Peter has now gotten the girl of his dreams, so it seems. Peter now believes that they cannot be together because of his responsibility as Spider-Man. He leaves the funeral and ends the film with an inner monologue.
Whatever life holds in store for me, I will never forget these words. With great power comes great responsibility. This is my gift, my curse. Who am I? I'm Spider-Man.
Through the protagonist, Peter Parker, in this story, we learn that despite of what others will say, doing the right thing is always the higher road. Doing the right thing isn't always glamorous, but it is always noble. Anyways, that wraps up today's video essay. And if you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a like. And if you want more content like this, hit the subscribe button and ring the bell notification so you can be notified every time I upload a new video. And shout out to Pierce Brosnan and Godzilla. Thanks for watching.